was a stormy night. You know the kind where the lightning strikes. And I was hanging out with some of my artsy friends. Ooh, ew, ew. The night was long, the night went on. We were cooling out through the break of dawn. Incense was burning, so I'm feeling right. I see, I picked my friends like a big fruit. Again, he told me that when I was only you. I don't walk around trying to be
my check. Yeah, I can hear. Yeah, I'm good. Good morning, good morning. Welcome to the Hall Street Journal. All right, we just went live on Facebook as well. Welcome to the Hall Street Journal. My name is Rob Hall. We're here to educate, edify, enlighten, and entertain. Real Talk is in the building. I'm excited to be here this morning. You know, it's another Monday morning. Great things are happening. I'm in the studio with my engineer extraordinaire, also host extraordinaire, Mr. Roland Grimes. What's up, Roland?
Hey, Rob. How you doing, man?
Hey, I appreciate you for being here.
It's a pleasure.
You know, I'm trying to figure out all this Facebook Live movements.
I turned you on to that, didn't I?
Yeah, you did.
Awesome.
You did. I had no idea what I was doing, y'all. See, it's funny because there's a lot of things you might want to do or know or have in life. And quite often, the difference is simply knowing. You just don't know. You know, when you know better, you do better. But when you don't, you know, there's problems. So a lot of people have interest in things like personal wealth strategies, understanding money and finance better. And it's not that they couldn't do better. It's just that they don't know better. They're just missing a little piece of information or just missing a key. You know, I was talking to somebody the other day about, and she was explaining how difficult certain things tend to be. And we were sitting inside of a Starbucks, and I looked up at the door. Oh, I looked up at the door. I almost ended my live video. That's crazy. I looked up at the door to the Starbucks, and I said, "You see that door? It's a pretty easy apparatus to operate, right? You just kind of walk up, push it, and go out. But if I were to walk up to that door and turn the little silver knob that locks it, and you didn't understand what that little knob does, well, you would walk up to that door and push and pull and push and pull for potentially for a very long time. I mean, you could freaking starve to death. Who knows what would happen if you didn't understand simply that to get out, you need to unlock the door. You had all the strength, you had all the capabilities, you just didn't know, you know? And that's just how situations can be sometimes in life, you know? We have these opportunities, we have these possibilities, we just don't know, right? So here's to whatever little lock there is on the door that you've been desiring to open. You know, you want to see something happen, see something better happen in your life, and you're just looking for that key, that lock, that ability to go to the next level. All right. And a lot of times it's not something that you don't have. It's not something that you need. You have everything you need. You have all of the capabilities. You just, that little bit of information will make all the difference in the world. Right. So we're going to talk today. We actually got an exciting show today. We're going to have a caller that calls in that's going to talk a little bit about economics. But what's interesting is that the person calling to talk about economics is a man of the cloth. And most of the times people say, oh, well, wait a minute. Money is the root of all evil. And they look at money as a negative thing, you know, in church. You know, they accuse people of stealing, which I'm sure some of that happens. And all these other type of things that go on. Now, it's not everybody, but it happens. And some people get involved in things so they can get rich. and they say money is the root of all evil, but actually it's just the love of money is what the Bible says is the root of all evil, the love. And so we're not going to love it, but what we're going to do is utilize it as a tool to achieve our goals in life, to achieve our goals on this earth, to leave an inheritance for our children, to enjoy the earth that God gave us and the resources that he blessed us with. The Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. So, you know, hey, we should be able to do some positive things here on the earth with our with all the God-given abilities, gifts, talents, all the faculties he's given us. There's nothing but, there's so much opportunity out here, particularly in this country called America. And now I'm excited to be an American son. I see a lot that's going on in the streets with the black-on-black violence and crime. Then I also see what's going on in the streets with police brutality and just literally murdering people in the name of justice. And we don't stand for that with the Wall Street Journal. We're going to call it what it is. It's absolutely murder in the name of justice, which is kind of the most, it's the most heinous type of murder, because the people who are sworn the oath to protect us have a higher standard to bear. They're held to a higher standard. Leniency.
Yeah, they're given more latitude to make those decisions.
That's the word I was looking for. They're given more latitude, and they're held to a higher standard. So when they go out there and they commit murder with the uniform on, it's a really a disgrace and a to society as a whole. And it's a disservice to the ones who are doing the jobs the way they're supposed to be done. And it's a difficult job for sure. So, you know, I've been witnessing and watching just like everybody else. And, you know, sometimes it's frustrating because you're not, you know, maybe you feel like, you know, what am I supposed to do? You know, what action am I supposed to take? I mean, I got a text message from a group of brothers that I'm cool with. And, you know, we're tight on the morning after the murder in Tulsa by the officer. And, you know, it's really about, you know, okay, what's next? Like, how many times do we have to see this replay? Okay. How many times do we have to see this replayed? How many videos do we need to watch? How high in the air does a man have to hold his hands to demonstrate that he is not a threat? I mean, we've seen men sitting on the ground with their hands in the air, shot anyway. You know, the gentleman who was working with the guy who had the disabilities. I mean, hands in the air, absolutely not a threat, and you still get shot. And so, you know, it's disheartening. But what's interesting is we're going to get a call in because, you know, at the heart of some of this social ills is economics. You know, and even some of the responses, which I've favored, the responses which are economic, which say, okay, we're not going to patronize certain businesses, or we're gonna start, you know, hitting people where it hurts, hitting American society where it hurts financially, and start holding on to our money or not spending it at certain stores, and just kind of making statements to say, hey, this isn't okay, and we're not gonna just continue business as usual while we're dying and our blood is running in the streets. Literally, that is just it's not going to happen. But economics is important. It's an important linchpin in our societal standing. It changes the way people view and interact with us. And the power of the African American community, the power of the black dollar and spending dollar, it's renowned, but we really have not capitalized on it in the ways that we could. You know, I see it kind of like kinetic energy, you know? No, I'm sorry. I see it as potential energy that could become kinetic. You know, it has possibility, but we have to figure out how to activate it. Some say, okay, well, let's put our money in black banks. Well, I got a call, a couple texts, emails about putting our money in black banks, and is this a good move? Is this a bad move? Again, it's potential energy. I mean, if we make massive deposits in black banks, then those black banks will be stronger as far as their repositories of cash are concerned. They'll have access to more funds, access to more funds through the Federal Reserve System. They'll have the potential to do something that could be impactful in the community. For instance, they have the potential to issue more loans to help more people become homeowners or to help more people finance businesses. But those banks have to make that decision. They can't just simply get the cash and sit on it and have it be something that they show off on their books. There has to be active circulation of capital back into the community that is supporting the bank. That is the premise for how we can really make it work, how we can make it make sense as a strategic move. If you put the money in the bank needs to turn around and reinvest capital in you. They have access to lots of funds through the Federal Reserve System, and they can go out here and lend massive amounts of money as a result of those deposits. And so that is really what's going to make a big difference, not just simply going to put your $100 in the bank and saying, hey, I stuck it to the man. Really, you didn't.
Robert, yes, got a question for you.
Yeah, hit me.
We've survived this long without developing an economic strategy for empowerment. We've survived as a people this long. And as a result of that, there's a lot of folks who really aren't excited about, animated about the need for a cohesive upgroup economic movement.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain to those folks, if we do not do some of that, what happens to our future and the future of our children?
Well, you said a key word in the beginning. You said we've survived this long. And the question is, do you want to survive or do you want to thrive? And I've watched other communities thrive. I've watched, you can see Caucasian communities, Jewish communities. Other communities are thriving as a result of their economic activity. And we can't beat our chest about merely surviving. And then there's conditions under which we survive, where we have this different socioeconomic status. If we want to change that for our children and our children's children, we have to start doing things differently. And that involves not just our moves economically, but also politically and socially. But the economic aspect is paramount. Those who lack resources just don't get the same type of treatment in society. So I think we need to do it for our children and our children's children. I think a lot of the problems is it's easy to fear things that you don't understand. You know, I don't know what they're talking about, and I don't want to get involved in that. We don't need to do that. Okay, so we can eradicate that fear by increasing the levels of understanding. And as we talked last week on the show, educational movement is hugely important, because what it will do is it will give people the foundational understanding required to embrace these movements. They're rejecting it because they don't get it. They don't understand it.
That's a great point. Now, one of the conversations that came up with the person who's going to be calling in a little later, mm-hmm. Pastor Galladay, is the need for comprehensive academic approaches to economics that we control, that we design, instead of depending on schools and other institutions to do that for our children and for our adults,
mm-hmm.
that we develop these comprehensive economic, strategic learning programs across the nation ourselves,
mm.
for the 70-year-old, the 50-year-old, the 30-year-old, the 10-year-old.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just curious as to, have you ever thought about what that kind of schooling may look like? Because we have the internet now, we can do a lot of it virtually.
Mm-hmm.
But some of the elements or aspects of it, how do we get, and this is an unfair question, but what would you like to see happen in order to get folks excited about, because you know our people, mm-hmm. especially.
Absolutely.
To get excited about spending a couple of hours a week just concentrating on understanding economic and political moves.
Wow. Well, I don't know. I mean, if you go to my website, my website is hallstreetjournal.com. There's a book there called The Principles. And I wrote The Principles literally over 10 years ago. I've been working on it for a decade. There's no good excuse for why I've been working on it for a decade. But on and off, I've been working on it. And we're releasing this curriculum. But what I found is that people don't have to have all the fine details of finance to change their lives. They don't have to necessarily become masters of Japanese candlestick charts and to do technical analysis and of their stock portfolios or technical analysis of different stocks and start trading. And they don't have to get the every finite detail, but they need the fundamentals. They need the principles. And when I was functioning as a consultant, lots of times I would get questions that I go to myself, boy, if this client of mine just knew some very basic fundamentals, they could answer this question for themselves. And so, you know, I developed a curriculum called The Principles, and I think there should be more curriculums like that. Kelstar had a nice curriculum that he mentioned last week for financial literacy. But the fundamentals of finance, income, expenses, assets, liability, cash flow, and net worth. I hammer that and hammer that and hammer that, that we need to understand those, the four legs of that table: income, expenses, assets, and liabilities. And, cash flow and net worth are really just comparative calculations that really result from comparing income to expenses and comparing assets to liabilities. But when we understand the fundamentals, when we realize what it can do for us, for our community, for our families, for our children, it becomes easier to get excited about it, to embrace it. But I think even bigger piece is it's all in the delivery. It's all in the language that is used. You know, what the pastor was talking about, I think, is people might say, well, why? Why do we need black people to develop their own curriculums? If in fact one and one is two, no matter what color you are, why do you need black people to develop it? And I think the answer to that is because black people understand the cultural experience and the the vernacular of black people. Most of the information that's out there is written by white men.
You just had a note put up on Facebook. This is a real interesting kind of comment. Mm-hmm. And Locks out of North Carolina just said that we need to move our thinking from big hat, no cattle, to little hat, lots of cattle. Mm-hmm. And I think what he's referring to is lifestyle. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, I've heard that concept before. We rather look good than be doing good. We rather pretend that we understand than actually understand. And we certainly have to get away from that as, you know, kind of like our objective, our destination is to look good. You know, we just want the shirt with the right name on it, or the jeans with the right name on it, or the shoes or the car with the right name on it. That's our big hat, but we don't have anything. Versus, you know, see lots of people who are well off who, you know, they're just wearing jeans and T-shirts, and they're you know, driving a simple vehicle, but you know, they're quite well off. And so certainly there's that, but the rest of the story is that there are people who are well off and they look good and they dress well, you know, and they drive in a Ferrari 599. Now, how and when do we get to that point where we have plenty of cattle and big hat? The transition should probably be to what the gentleman mentioned, to start off with the little hat and lots of cattle. But you can get to the big hat if you have the big hat understanding. That's the big difference to me, is that we need to get a different type of understanding, so that we can merit the big hats that we want to just go throw on our heads. All right, so listen, we're going to take a break. And when we come back, we've got a guest calling in that we're excited about. And so we appreciate you for listening to the Hall Street Journal. We're going to sign out for a moment here. We're here to educate, edify, enlighten, and entertain. We'll talk in the building. All right, we're back on the Hall Street Journal. My name is Rob Hall. I'm the editor-in-chief of HallStreetJournal.com. We are here to educate, edify, enlighten, and entertain. We appreciate y'all for joining the show once again. And we're excited. I'm in the studio right now, eLive Media, powered by Live Music for You, with my able engineer and also able host, Mr. Roland Grimes. What's up, Roland?
Hey, how's everyone this morning?
All right. So if y'all hear that like super professional voice, y'all know who it is. Roland doing this thing. So we got some callers calling in. I'm excited about what's the name of our who's our caller this morning?
Your caller will be Pastor J.D. Galladay out of I believe the church in Northeast Washington, D.C.
Okay. So we're going to be on our best behavior because we got a man in the cloth calling in. But he's going to talk about something that we
show you right.
We got a man in the cloth calling in. But he wants to talk about something that is very important, and that's economics and economic empowerment in the black community in particular, and how important it is for us to get our education right, get our understanding right, and start getting involved in this thing capitalism in this country where we live. You know what I'm saying? A lot of us, we out here, and I hear the call coming in. We out here involved in a capitalist society, but we're not capitalistic and we're not capitalizing. So we need to get these things together. Get this understanding together.
Robin Hall.
And Pastor Holiday is passionate. He's excited about this movement, about that idea, among others. But we're excited to have him on the show. Pastor Holiday, are you there?
Pastor Galladay.
Galladay, excuse me. Pastor,
yes,
Galladay.
Sir. I'm right here, Mr. Hall. How are you?
I'm well. How are you doing this morning, sir?
I'm doing wonderful. Almost drive to work, but I'm doing good.
Excellent. So we appreciate you for taking the time to call into the Hall Street Journal and have a conversation with us about one of your passion points, which is, as I understand, the economics in our community.
Yes, sir. I'm glad to be a part.
All right. Well, we appreciate you for being here. So why is it that you are so passionate about economics, you know, being a man of God? What is it about economics that you're really excited about or interested in, and what draws you to that as a movement in our community?
Well, I'm really passionate about, you know, our community having more of a sense about financial literacy, you know, so that they can come that our own dollar will sink our neighborhood, and we can finance our own street instead of having to go to others to have our own finance.
You said a dollar's in our community, and we do what now?
I was saying that our dollar doesn't even stay in our own community long enough in order for us to be in power.
Right.
Our dollar constantly goes to other neighborhoods, and we wonder why they're fighting, and we're not. So I would love to see our dollar be able to stay in our own neighborhood, and I believe that's going to fit the financial literacy. So we're not only our credit score goes higher, but our own dream to be able to finance more businesses in the neighborhood, more employment from our own people in our neighborhood, and I want to see us more power.
of the things that people always talk about, Pastor, is, you know, the dollar circulate more in our community.
That's
and
right.
I think that is important, the point that you brought up. The rest of the story, though, is that if our dollars are going to circulate in our community, then we need to have viable operational businesses that provide for that opportunity to happen. So, you know, I'm sitting in the studio looking across, for instance, at a Goodyear shop. I mean, how many Goodyear shops do we own? Or how many supermarkets do we own? Or just smaller businesses, what businesses do we own and operate at high level of efficiency that allows us to continue to patronize one another's businesses? And so that's kind of like the opposite end of the coin. For those who want to get involved and support black businesses, that's of course, that's phenomenal. That's what we want to see. But we need some African-American entrepreneurs who start companies, start businesses, and then operate them at a level of excellence, whereas they are competitive and they deliver quality, and there's fairness, and there's a great experience. Because so many people say, hey, I try to go to a black business and I don't have always the best experience. And I think there is a responsibility for us to do that as well.
Well, I agree, and that's why I believe that, you know, an education for financial services should be handed down to the next generation and to the current generation. But, you know, I'm still above ground, so it's not too late for me. And so there's an education that needs to go forth, and I would love to see more of our people, instead of, you know, especially the younger people, not only pursue, you know, the entertainment industry, which they're pursuing, or sports, which the majority of our people are, you know, in. Let's get into the business arena, where we have, you know, as Roland and I were talking about on Friday.
Absolutely.
What about the growth store? What about farmers? So we can feed, so we can send our own food to our own grocery store. You know, there are opportunities wide open for all of us to participate in.
Absolutely. My older brother told it to me like this. When I was young, getting started in business, he said, Robbie, there's a lot of businesses out there that make a lot of money. He said they don't make a girl smile at a bar, but they make a lot of money. And what he meant by that is, you know, it sounds great to say, hey, I'm a producer, or I'm a singer, I'm a rapper, or I'm a ball player, or whatever. But, you know, there's somebody who's making millions of dollars off heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. There's somebody who's making millions of dollars in the asphalt business. There's people who are making millions of dollars selling rocks that get, you know, for landscaping purposes. So here are some businesses, some ideas. You know, I'm in somebody in the drywall business. All those walls that have to go up. These aren't things that make a girl smile at a bar, proverbially, but they are things that make massive amounts of money. And so there's so many other businesses that we can get involved in if we were exposed to them, or we would expose ourselves to them. And get out there and do some research and get involved. Everybody doesn't have to be an athlete and an entertainer, so I absolutely agree with you there.
That's correct. And, you know, I've been running into some young people who have been participating in other industries. A young man who grew up in our church basically had joined the Navy, and he went to the Navy, and, you know, he was enlisted, and he stayed 9 years, but as he went to the Navy, he earned his degree in biology and in chemistry. And now he is almost finished with becoming a doctor, an MD. And so, you know, I commend the young man for wanting to feel that's, you know, different than entertainment and sport. And, you know, that's the deceit. You know, my own son, he's a writer, and today he meets with a black company, a black film company. You know, the writers are meeting today, and that's what we need to see in our community.
Absolutely. And let me tell you, even it's great for the youth, but it's also fantastic for those who are middle class, middle age, and even older. I mean, Ray Kroc started McDonald's when he was 63 years old. You know, the Colonel Sanders wasn't a spring chicken when he started Kentucky Fried Chicken. So there are quite there are a lot of stories of seniors and folks in their middle age who come up with business ideas that change the world. Sam Walton wasn't young either, and his Walmart has created the greatest fortune on the face of the earth. So, you know, don't you can't count out anybody. If you have passion and tenacity and temerity and insight and vision, and you know how to go out here and get the provision, it's quite possible for you to do phenomenal things and incorporate some of the youth into the plan that you have to execute. And our youth have to understand that everybody doesn't have to be the CEO or the president in order to be successful. I always tell people I'd rather have 10% of Def Jam than 100% of Basement Records. And so we're so busy trying to always run our own company.
Hey, wait a minute, Basement Records, that was mine.
Right. You know, we'd rather be the CEO of nothing. You know, well, we got to understand, especially in the black community, how to create coalitions. Steve Ballmer did not start Microsoft, right? Steve Ballmer joined Microsoft in like 1980, okay? Microsoft began in 76. Ballmer comes along in 80 and joins the company and brings a lot to bear, brings a lot to the table, helps to grow the company. Steve Ballmer, well, he's worth like $22 billion. Became the owner of the Clippers. He didn't start the company, but he brought value to the company and he helped it grow. So,
you know, and that's a real good point, because those kinds of things we don't get to hear very often. I mean, that point you just made, I knew it, but I forgot it, and I don't talk about it. So part of what happens is we don't have these conversations at the dinner table, Pastor Robert. We don't have these conversations when we're sitting at Buffalo Wild Wings or Everlasting Life and we're watching the game. So you talk about financial literacy, and that's a rather abstract term. But Pastor, in moving in that direction, you are advocating for the development of some kind of educational system, some kind of school or schooling that we could participate in to get some of that business acumen and some of that understanding of economics. Talk a little bit about your interest in, your desire for, and perhaps your vision for that kind of schooling before we let you go.
Yes, my vision is all the information that I've learned and am learning, I want to be able to pass it down, you know, so that our younger folks will be able to be educated in the field of finance. And if they'll know, and one of the things that I was taught was that when you not only build wealth, you build income for your later years. So not that you won't have access to your money as it grows, but you'll be able to take the money and put it into something that it will generate income so that you don't have to, you know, physically get up and go to work every day, but it will produce for you so that it will help you build wealth. And if I can teach people how, you know, and develop a school that will teach people how to embrace that concept, I've done my job. And that's what I'm looking forward to. I want to be able to tap into the community, take a hold, not just my folks. As you said, I want to get old folks equipped. The school will be open to everybody. That you'll be able to, you know, get educated in the area of finance and have a financial literacy, that you'll have, you know, savings, which a lot of us don't have, which you'll have income growing and income coming to you as you build your wealth. And so I want to be able to pass that down, you know, to the community.
Well, that's exciting. I would love to connect to what you're doing. Like I mentioned earlier, we've developed a curriculum, and of course, one of our major focuses is to define wealth as having passive income that's greater than or equal to your expenses. And the key to that is acquiring income-producing assets that create that passive income to sustain your lifestyle. And so that's a fundamental principle that we teach in our curriculum. And we've always... want to work with churches, because I can tell you, when you're talking about economics in the black community, by far, bar none, the most powerful institution in the black community is the black church. And if you want to create change in the black community, the place to go, and implement that change, the vehicle through which to implement that change most powerfully and most effectively is the church. So we need to bring these curricula. We already have the schools. We already have a national university. It is the community of churches. They already have bookstores. They already have a place for folks to sit and meet and congregate, gather and talk. So we need more of this type of dialogue between those who have the vision and those who have some of the curriculum and some of the other information and want to make those connections with churches.
Oh, I agree. And I believe if you have a vision for a certain thing, and as the scripture says, the people perish without a vision. And I believe that vision, you know, between the three of us here, you know, impacts the community. And I believe, you know, Jeff, I would love to connect with you and check out your curriculum and implement some things in the church. You know, I'm open and I'm available.
All right, well, Pastor, we appreciate you for calling in. We appreciate your insight. We appreciate your passion and the vision that you have to make it a reality for the benefit of people who are truly in need. And that's really what it's all about, having that responsibility to something greater than yourself. And we just appreciate you for having that kind of heart for the community and bringing this real information to go along with the inspiration that we get every Sunday.
And of course, Robert, as I mentioned to you before, I'd love to have you and Pastor Galladay on my show one Monday night. And we'll collaborate together, figure out what Monday night that will be. JD, are you taking classes on Monday night now?
I am, but I can make room in my schedule.
Awesome.
As long as I know ahead of time.
Great. So we'll try to arrange that because we need to have that kind of conversation face to face in front of everybody.
Absolutely.
All right.
Appreciate you. Pastor, we'll be in touch.
Thanks again, guys, for calling. Thanks for having me tomorrow.
All right, sir. Take care.
All right, be blessed.
Likewise. All right, so it is the top of the hour. We are going to be taking another break. We are excited about the call we just got and the conversation we just had. By far, bar none, the church. And we need to be connected to our communities. We appreciate you for listening to the Hall Street Journal. We're here to educate, edify, enlighten, and entertain. Real talk is in the building. Y'all, we'll see you right after the break.
Elevation, revelation, celebration, baby. Elevation. Revelation, revelation, celebration. Let me take you.
Heaven's in the backseat of my Cadillac. Heaven's in the backseat of my Cadillac.
Let me take you there. Let me take you there. Let me take you there.
Yeah. I'm taking my freedom, pulling it off the shelf, putting it on my chain, wearing it round my neck. I'm taking my freedom, putting it in my car, wherever I choose to go, it won't take me far. I'm living my life like it's golden, living my life like it's golden, living my life.
Are you living your life like it's golden? This is Rob Hall. You listening to the Hall Street Journal. We are here on eLife Media, powered by Live Music for You. Hall Street Journal is here to educate, edify, enlighten, and entertain. We are live. We're going Ustream. We're going YouTube. We're on Facebook Live.
Yes, yes, yes.
We're getting it in. I got my man Roland in the studio.
Just want to remind you, call in 240-455-5934, 240-455-5934. Robert Hall on the Hall Street Journal.
Yeah, we are here. We are here. And we got the national treasure in the building, yes, Sir Clarence Sanders. Tell that, you know that man sharp right now. That man sharp. That man got all the gold in Johannesburg up in this jump.
Robert, you just had a chance to hear from some very dynamic people across the country, man.
Yes.
Derek from your neck of the woods, Central New York, upstate New York, Derek.
Representing,
out of Syracuse, he said, man, he loves this.
He from Cuse, you know, I'm from Utica. And, you know, that's where I grew up at. You know, that's why I claim, you know, I love my city, UT representing. And that's
okay,
always good
that.
To know that. Yeah, yeah, Utica, New York. If you don't know, you'll find out. We doing big things. We doing big things. We all over the country. You know what I'm saying?
So Derek said he loves it, man. Bernard said that it starts with education.
Absolutely, it starts with education. The true evil in this world is ignorance. And you eradicate it through education. And we just haven't had a vernacular, a financial literacy discussion, conversation in language that we understand, you know, and that's why we're excited about Hall Street Journal, because that's what we're going to do. We're going to have these conversations because, you know, if we don't, and we just keep acting like we understand and we really don't understand, then, you know, we're going to be lost. And more importantly, our children are going to be lost and their children are going to be lost. You know, so we're going to talk about, and you can call into the show anytime and ask us about anything in finance, anything.
240-455-5934.
Yes, there it is. Call us and ask us. I mean, this is the information age. I mean, you can Google so much. There's a lot of information out there, but the reality is you need to understand how to put all the pieces of the puzzle together. And, you know, the rabbit hole can get deep, but the beauty of the principles, which is what we utilize when we're counseling any and everybody or talking to anyone about finance, educating, I'll say, is that it's comprehensive. It deals with everything. And if you get the information, it starts out with understanding the fundamentals, which is income, expenses, assets, and liability. What is that, Rob Hall? That's what's coming in, what's going out, what do you own, and what do you owe?
Robert, I'm going to ask you to repeat that again. Income?
Income, expenses, assets, and liabilities.
I-E-A-L. I-E-A-L.
I-E-A-L, absolutely. Gotcha. Income, expenses, assets, and liabilities. It's what is coming in, that's your income. What's going out, that's your expenses. What do you own? Those are your assets. And what do you owe? Your long-term liabilities. Those are the four legs of the table. So often, we measure ourselves simply by income, Roland. Everybody's focused on income. How much income can I bring in? Bringing in income is like my whole world. That's my whole focus. But and sisters would be like, you know, telling each other, oh, I just met this guy. He's so great. He's so this. He's so that. And her girlfriends would be like, oh, well, what does he do? And now, how many of you know that when a sister asks her girlfriend, what does he do? What she's actually trying to figure out is how much does he make?
How much does he make?
That's what she's trying to figure out. She said, what does he do? Like, because if you say he's a doctor, she's going to figure he makes a lot or brings in a lot. He has a lot of income. So, wow, he must be a great catch. But 25% of the table is income. That's only one fourth of what you need to understand. I mean, what if he's making $250,000 a year or $300,000 a year, but he's spending $350,000 a year? He might be short.
You know, that's a real good point, brother. So I'm going to go there. You
mm-hmm.
ready?
Mm-hmm.
There's no such thing as being able to maintain a relationship with a lady without spending money.
True.
Pastor, am I wrong with that? You're going to have to spend some money on her.
True.
Now, part of the question is, what types of things can we do together that makes sense with us making an investment in her where we're not just spending money on activity and on transiency, but we're spending money and making an investment in her? And how do we help her understand that that investment that we're making in her is for our future development, hope, and opportunity? How does that happen? Or can it happen?
That is a question.
Sir, bam!
Sir Clarence Sanders, I mean, do you have the answer for that one? Because I don't know if I'm big on investing in her. I want to see our relationship. I want to invest in the relationship. And then we invest. Oh, we got a caller. Roland. Hey, I didn't do it. I did not do it. The phone started ringing off the hook.
Put it on me.
Because he done got the sisters.
He like me to Roland Grimes on the Hall of Fame. Who's calling?
We paying for sisters Reggie now. Reds.
How you doing?
Awesome. So, Red, yeah.
I'm going to put you on the phone for a minute, Red. So you just sit tight.
Yeah, we got calls coming in. But I mean, to me, you know, finance in a relationship, you need to have a similar vision of where you're at, what you're trying to achieve, and be able to have open conversations about your financial goals as you're moving forward. And when one person lacks understanding, they either have to simply follow or
get out the way.
There's gonna be conflict. Gonna be conflict.
Now you have a caller on the line now, and this brother loves talking finance and economics.
Okay.
And I don't know if he has questions or commentary, but he did say we're looking good on the air.
Okay.
He said we're sounding good on the air.
Okay.
And I just want to introduce you, or reintroduce you to brother Reg Robert Hall. Reg, are you there?
I'm here, brother.
Now you've made many, many business related financial decisions. How do you make those decisions, and if you could do anything differently moving forward, what would you recommend to the folks to do?
You know, I'll say what's up, Rob Hall? How you doing, bro?
Man, I'm blessed, man. I'm excited. I'm on the Hall Street Journal. I can't complain.
What's going on, player? Hey, look, man, I've done a lot of things, the financial things, but I jumped out there a lot of time without consulting my wife. So now, you know, I'm a little older. I try to consult with my wife before I make a move because I'm the spender. She's the saver. You know what I'm saying? I go out there and just spend, but she's the saver. She keeps me grounded. So if I had to do anything different, I would definitely consult with her on a lot of different things before I would make some of the decisions I made before. So now that's a learning experience for me, is to consult with her first. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, yes. And that's a huge piece. You know, if your wife is your helpmeet, she should be someone that you can go to for good counsel. You should be able to go to her and say, baby, what do you think about this? And then she give you a perspective that maybe you would not naturally have seen. And then you take that into an account as you're making your decisions. And so with wisdom and maturity, as you've grown in your relationship and in life, you realize, you know, how valuable and important that is to have a wife that that you can get counsel for. But the other big piece to me is she has
who's
a husband.
Who's counseling her, right?
Well, no. Well, my big deal is that she has faith in him.
Oh.
After she delivers his counsel, she trusts his ability to go out and make the decisions. You know, and I think that's the way it should be. He shouldn't move without her. And then once he consults with her, she should have faith and confidence to support him in his decisions, even though all of them won't absolutely be correct, but she'll support him.
That's a real good point. What do we have to do with her to help her to understand that it's not a straight line to economic success? It's full of curves and divots and valleys and peaks.
Right.
Brother Reg, and Robert Hall. Help me understand, how do we communicate that?
I mean, it's difficult, especially because, you know, I'm a gambler and she's not, you know, so she has to understand the inroad is, you know, is to help the family, you know, overall the inroad is to help the family. Once she understands that, it's everything you do is a little risk involved. So, right. you try to limit your risk, but you can't limit it 100%. So, you know, she has to be able to gamble a little bit because you got to play to win. If you don't play, you're not
going to
win.
Absolutely. And really, as long as she has faith in the element that you mentioned about that your objectives are for the benefit of the family, sometimes that's all you can go on is what your objectives are. And wherever there's less risk, there's less potential for gain. That's what I always teach. If you have less risk, there's less potential for gain. And whenever you have a guarantee, you have a guaranteed loss. So right. For those of you who are looking for guarantees, you're looking for losses.
Wait a minute, restate that.
Wherever there is less risk, there is less potential for gain. And wherever you have a guarantee, you have a guaranteed loss. What do I mean by that? If you go to the bank, they might guarantee you 3% interest on a CD or something, right? But that means if you put $1,000 in at the end of the year, they're going to give you back $1,030. And here's the problem. The $30 is capital gains and you owe taxes on it. Let's say you give up 20 cents on a dollar. Okay? So now you just lost $6 to taxes. All right? Now you're talking about you got 14 bucks left. $14 is what you're
24.
I'm sorry, $24 left. $24 is what you actually have left. And in reality, inflation was 3%, 3.5%, you know, something like that. So by the time the inflation and taxes eat up the $30, you actually lost buying power. So you got a guarantee, but in effect, it's a loss.
Right.
So which is why they'll guarantee they'll give it to you, because they can't lose when you do stuff like that.
And also, when there's a guarantee, there's very little active participation on your end. Is that correct?
Something more often than not, they're going to offer you that. I mean,
you're not making the decisions when there's guarantees. When there's guarantees, someone's making those decisions for you.
Right. I mean, I don't even believe in guarantee.
I got that.
They'll state that there's a guarantee, and then they'll take over control, as you just laid out. And then maybe it happens, maybe it doesn't. Or if it does happen, the terms were so bad to begin with that even their delivery didn't matter.
Brother Robert, Brother Reg, we talked earlier with Pastor Galladay about financial literacy and the need for a continuing education. What role or how important is black media to helping us to better understand this world of economics, business, and movement?
It's all about getting the word out. You know, the same thing Brother Hall is doing, man. Programs like he has, man, really educating our folks in media that wouldn't be mainstream. And this opportunity of Eli Media and the Hall Street Journal giving us the education that a lot of people may not get on mainstream. Mainstream is not going to give us the heart and soul of what our community really needs to get the word out, how we really make money and save money. So this media that we're doing right now and the Hall Street Journal is an excellent avenue and conduit for our people who may not normally get this mainstream of media.
Wow, Reggie Reg. What's up, brother? I appreciate the shout out. Because that's what we need is that type of support and people understand what we're trying to do and what we're looking to accomplish. And not only that, not only did Reg give us a support as far as, you know, some encouragement, but he took the time to pick up the phone and engage the conversation. You know, my entire professional goal is to be a fantastic facilitator of conversations that need to be had. This is a conversation we need to have. We need to talk about this. And I want to get into some substance week after week, some detail. Let's really get into the numbers and break down what wealth is, what wealth is about, how we create it. We can talk about trading stocks. We can talk about investing in real estate. We can talk about asset protection systems like insurance. We can talk about estate plans. We can talk about tax strategies. There's a lot of stuff that we really need to just pull back. I don't have every answer. Of course not. But I'm excited about working with the community to get to the bottom, to get to the answers. And we have, as black people, amazing brains, amazing capabilities. All we need to do is break down the barriers of our lack of understanding, and we can do phenomenal things.
Hey, look here, Rob. I got a roll rolling. Rob, I got a roll. But Rob, give me a call after the show, man. I got something good for you. We talked about that you need to get out there. And yes. I made it affordable for you. So just give me a call after you off the show tonight, all right?
Black Media on the move.
Will do. Will do. Appreciate you, sir.
All right, brother.
Brother Hall.
Yes, sir.
Belinda says, great talk, great conversation.
That's what it is. That's what it is, great conversation. We would love for Belinda to call in and participate. Anybody, and we appreciate you for making that comment, Belinda, 240-455-5934. You can call into the studio, and we can have a conversation. Some serious questions that we can address. We're still live. We're still going. I got a national treasure, the national treasure, my brother, Sir. You got to put Sir at the front of this. Sir Clarence Sanders in the building. Mr. Sanders, can you give us your advice to the audience about how to move yourself forward, even though you might face some difficult times in life financially? How is it after your life? I mean, you've been doing it for a long time successfully, I can tell. But all this gold this man brought into the studio, that he's not broke. How do you survive the difficult times and still come back?
By setting goals, short-term goals, long-term goals, and a roadmap to show you how to reach those goals and become financially secure, learning to secure your future without having your hand out expecting others to do that for you, to take the initiative. And it's easier said than done. I remember I had no goals, living from hand to mouth, but even before that, no job, standing in the unemployment line many times. But you can't waddle in negatives and doubt, low self-esteem, the negative remarks that people make, focusing on what's not going to help you grow spiritually, intellectually, and physically. And you cannot progress wasting time. You cannot regain the time that you waste. When I start setting goals and working towards those goals, and I found that I was able to move forward with my life rather than expect for someone else to help me. I worked for the federal government for over 41 years and 2 months, and I had no idea that I was going to be able to accomplish as much as I've accomplished with my life, and still going forward, and being around people who are positive, and working to keep myself positive in my endeavors.
Let me stop you right there, Sir Clarence, because he hit a lot of positive points, right? About self-determination, not sitting around waiting for someone to solve your problems for you, even, and not wallowing in self-doubt or self-pity, but really kind of stepping up and taking the bull by the horns, you know, carpe diem, seize the day.
See, you get ready to make me go out on this football field. Give me that pep talk.
Hey, let's go. You need a pep talk. We need two things. We need inspiration and information.
All right, brother. We got to call her.
Hold
that thought. She's on her way to work. And she just wanted to let you know how valuable some of the conversation is. Belinda, are you on the line?
Yes. Good morning.
How you doing? Terrific.
Good morning, Belinda. We appreciate you for calling in. I guess I called you out, huh?
Yes, you did.
I appreciate you because you stepped up, though. You stepped up. Where are you calling from?
Bowie, Maryland.
Oh, wow. Wow, we love, you know, there's something about the sisters in Bowie.
Something about them.
Yes.
Gorgeous.
Yes.
I already know. I can tell over the phone. Okay, no, let me stop. Belinda, why do you feel shows like this are valuable?
I think that it's valuable because we don't do enough investment in our communities, and there's not enough financial literacy out there to educate us, you know, on what we should be investing in and how we should go about doing it. I personally only have, I'm hearing myself. I'm sorry.
Okay. Keep going. We hear you.
Okay. Yeah, so me personally, I only have like a checking account and a savings account. So I don't invest in like in IRAs and things like that. But I do invest in insurance. And that is like a whole life policy where it accrues, like a cash value. And that's the extent of my investment. And then when you were talking about a guarantee, I have done those CDs. Where they'll guarantee you a certain amount for about a year, you know, something like that. But the extent of that, I haven't invested in stocks and bonds and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Now that's one of the things we're going to end up needing to talk about when we talk about insurance. You know, the two major types of insurance are whole life insurance and term life insurance.
Yes.
And there was a massive movement in this country. That was about buying term life and investing the difference, which is the difference between the term.
That was the A.L. Williams movement.
Absolutely. Mr. Williams drove that one in a major way. And I think it had traction because it made sense for those who had the discipline to make the investment with the difference. For those who didn't have the discipline, maybe the whole life situation would have been better. But there are new things happening, even in the insurance industry, with annuities and other products that are getting quite dynamic as tax shelters.
Your index funds, your index-based ones as well.
Yes, yes. I mean, and we can talk about some, you know, the basic investment stuff, you know, like where you put money in to different mutual funds and things of that nature. But I'm just glad, Belinda, that you know, you've gotten a start. You understand that you need to get out here and make some investments. But I think what would be beneficial in our educational endeavors is to help people get a big picture. A big picture. Like, we know, oh, I should have some insurance, or I should, you know, it'd be good for me to have a will. Maybe I should have a financial statement. We know there's, or maybe I should buy a house and get involved in real estate. But we don't really understand how to put it all together, how they all work one with the other, right?
Right.
And so that's a valuable piece of curriculum that Hall Street Journal is going to be delivering, and we're delivering already, is let's pull back, let's get to 30,000 feet, let's look at the whole big picture, and then some of these financial services and activities start to make better sense when we can – when we understand the elements and how they fit. So I appreciate you for calling the show, Belinda, and just giving us a vote of confidence.
Yes, good job.
and representing Bowie.
Yes.
As only sisters from Bowie can do. you are welcome to call anytime. We apologize for the lightweight technical difficulties you hearing yourself, but listen, you sound nice, you sound great, you sound fantastic, and this is part of what inspires us to keep doing what we're doing.
Good job, guys.
All right, well, you have a great day.
You too.
All right. So there it is. We got a call in from Belinda. You know, we all excited now because we know we got, now we have three listeners. We now have four.
Yes. Well, actually, you have more listeners than that, but you've had three callers.
Hey, you know, I'm just joking, you know. I don't know. But you know what? The beauty of the new media is that we get out here and we put this stuff out in cyberspace, and what gets traction. And you just never know, you know, how far things go. It doesn't just live in the moment when you create it. So, you know, we're glad that we're here. We're glad that we have this opportunity provided by eLife Media. powered by Live Music for you. You are listening to the Hall Street Journal. We're here to educate, edify, enlighten, and entertain. Now, a lot of people don't know the A.L. Williams concept. You know, they don't understand what we're talking about. We're talking about whole life versus term life. But the bottom line is that whole life costs more money because there's a cash value that's built in. And then the term life does not have a cash value, so it costs less money. But it provides lots of insurance for that small amount of money. And the difference between the price, if you were to invest it, you can have it as cash for the long haul. I'm gonna tell you, I'm a term guy. I used to sell term over 20 years ago with Primerica, and I was pretty young looking 20 years ago, sitting with adults trying to teach them or talk to them about why they should buy term instead of a whole life. But again, insurance has changed over the last two decades. There's a lot of new policies. There's been kind of or types of products that are out there. But traditionally, whole life has been it's a difficult proposition because of the way it works. And for those of you who don't know how it works, I'm gonna give you the A.L. Williams. I'm gonna give you what the bottom line is. I used to do it like this. Let's say I have an account, okay? Call it a bank account, and I want you to put your money in this bank account. I'm the bank, and you're the depositor. And I said to you, and you said, okay, you're gonna deposit $100 a month in this account. And I said, okay, now let me tell you the rules for the account. For the first year or the first 2 years, all the $100 a month you put in there, I'm going to keep it. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. And after the year is over and I've taken a year of the cash, I'm going to start letting you build value in that account. And so the money's going to start to build value. That's your money. You're depositing it. But now, of course, you're going to have money in the account. I'm going to pay you interest, right? Well, the interest I'm going to pay you is going to be, say, 3%. I'll give you 3% interest on your money. Not really super high, but hey, I'm giving you something. And if you want to take any of your money out of that account, you can't just take it out. I know it's yours, but you can't take it out. You need to borrow it from me. Yeah, borrow your money from me. And I know I'm only paying you 3% interest, but I'm going to charge you 9% interest for your money. Is that all right so far? And then lastly, if you die, I'm going to keep it all. Is that cool? You want to put money in that account? Most people would say no. I'm not going to give you $100, let you keep the money for the first year, pay me 3%, make me borrow my own money, charge me 7, 8, 9%, and then if I die, you keep my money. Like, who's going to do something like that? Well, the answer is everybody with a whole life policy, because that's how cash value operates in a whole life in the policy. And people go, whoa, what do you mean? I got that my money in that type of account. And I would just simply say, listen, get the insurance agent who sold you this policy on the phone. And if they don't tell you that that's how it works, I'll have their license tomorrow. Because that's how whole life policies work. That's how cash values work. There's always, at least that's how it used to, there's always administrative fees in the front. So the initial monies that you're paying in overage above and beyond what's required to cover your the value on your policy is they take that up front. Also, they only pay, you know, a low interest rate on the cash value that they allow you to build after they've taken the administrative fees. The next thing is if you want cash value from your policy, you don't just get it. You actually have to borrow it from your policy. And then the interest rates are higher. The interest rates are higher than with the interest rates that they're paying you when you're leaving it sitting there. So they want you to pay more money than they want to pay you. And then, of course, if you have a whole life policy, the whole point is to pay you, pay your family in the event that you die. Well, let's say the face value of that policy is $100,000 and the cash value is $20,000. If you die, they don't give your family $120,000. they give your family the $100,000, but wait a minute, that's what you contracted for to begin with. How come they don't give you the cash value? They keep the cash value. So they really only gave your family $80,000 because $20,000 of it came from you anyway. So this is how whole life used to work. And this is why it was getting replaced very effectively. And then of course the rest of the story is, if you have a $200,000 policy that you have in insurance, and you're here with your wife, and you guys have been paying into this policy over all these decades, 20 years you've been paying this policy, and you got the big, there's some cash value, but the big money is in the death benefit. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't want to be sitting around my wife, and she looking at me, and I'm looking at her, and we trying to wait for the other one to die.
Wrong for that, man.
You know, which one of us going to die so the other one can enjoy life? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Well, what would you rather have? Would you rather have $200,000 life insurance policy, or would you rather have $200,000 in the bank? See, I'd rather have my $200,000 in the bank so me and my wife can get in the Winnebago and go out and ride around and have a good time. I don't want us to be sitting around struggling, and we've basically invested all our money into something that we can't access in the twilight of life. You know, that's what we want to have access to it. So, you know, it's a phenomenal it's a phenomenal tool for those who have the discipline. The problem is, if you buy term and then you don't invest the difference, eventually the term policy ends. It might be a 20-year term, 30-year term, but eventually it's going to end. And when it ends, you have nothing. You've paid all this money into the insurance, but you weren't disciplined enough to put money to the side. And so you outlive the policy, and there's nothing that can support you. So if you're going to embrace the smarter strategy, the important thing is to embrace the entire strategy. Don't just buy term policy. You absolutely must invest the difference somewhere in something that you can get some long-term stable growth. You know, some mutual fund or whatever, but put it into something. Don't spend it at the hair salon or at the movies or wherever you spend money on. Don't spend it. You gotta invest it. Sir Thomas. Sir Sanders.
Yes. Oftentimes people waste a lot of their money on what they want, not what they need. And I learned earlier on, and I listened to someone speak at Prince George's Community College about the scale of wants and needs. There have been many people, including myself, in the earlier years, wasting money when I learned that I should take what I'm spending, wasting, and invest it. When time come for me to spend money for what I need, I didn't have it because I spent too much on what I wanted. You know, our eyes are big when when our sisters and brothers go out and they see a lot of things that they don't really need, they're wasting it. And when time comes to spend for what they need, they don't have it. And they're crying the blues because you got 5 and 6 charge plates, which they'll run up to 19% interest on each charge plate. And if you don't pay that off, you're paying the creditors. That's how the creditors can afford to go out in the ocean on a $300 million yacht, because you footed the bill for that. You don't realize it.
Well, you know you're getting some sage advice when the advisor refers to your credit card as a charge plate. Wow.
So you got
too many charge plates. You heard it on Hall Street Journal.
So I had a wife, you know, she wanted to have 6-7 charge plates. But you can't see into the future that wife is going to pass away with your name on the charge plates. That means you got to pay those bills.
Mm.
See, those unforeseen things that we don't think about, you know, it's like buying a house. You think that all you're going to do is pay the down payment, and that, but you got a lot of expenses you have to focus on before you even think about buying a house, just like buying a car.
Right, right. Well, you know, you talked about potentially a spouse passing away, and we've been talking a little bit about life insurance, actually a lot of bit about life insurance. And I think it's important that, you know, as a community, we understand and utilize life insurance a little bit better than we have in the past. Because what that can do is nullify all of the liabilities that you've created in life if you got a policy in place, so you can know that you're not leaving anybody burdened with your bills. You're not leaving. I mean, we're in a situation where, you know, we often when we pass on and we got to take up money just to bury ourselves. And then other communities of folks pass on. Not only is the funeral covered, not only are all the liabilities covered, but there's also additional money there to help, children and children's children, grandchildren. The Catholic Church is one of the largest landowners in the world, in the United States in particular. How do you think the Catholic Church got so much of its property? The parishioners pass away and leave houses to the church, leave properties to the church in their wills. So when we think about the Black community, what would happen in the Black community if instead of us passing away and us having to do take up an offering just to bury somebody, they had a simple little policy in place to pay all the bills and then maybe left some money to a scholarship fund for the kids in the church. You know, those are things that we can do with the money we already have access to. You know, we could literally, every time somebody passed away, we have a celebration because, you know, Mr. Jackson or Sister Johnson, you know, even if they left $20,000 or $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 and said, this is going to be to establish a fund for youth in this church to better themselves and get education. Or this is going to be a fund that I'm going to leave to this church. Because when you put it in the will, you can dictate how that money is used. They can't just take it. You can say it's going to be in a trust. It's going to be controlled. The money that comes from it is going to be utilized to feed people who are hungry, or maybe create a fund to help people pay utility bills if they're behind. Or, you know, there's so many things you can think of that you can do. And maybe it doesn't happen while you're living, but you can do it. You can do it. I mean, it's just a number. The difference between what you would have paid for that, you know, for the $150,000 and $250,000 or even $200,000, it's not that great. But the impact is what you can do on the back end is huge. And I use that as an example because so many other communities actually do this. And that's part of why their intergenerational wealth is created and sustained through these contractual agreements is really all they are.
I'm out of the state of Florida. I went back to Florida to try to get my family to work, to have a family-owned business where we can keep the money in the family. Mm-hmm. But they totally disregarded me. Mm-hmm. So I said, never mind. I see division in our families. And the foreigners, they come here, they work together. I don't do a lot of focusing on what they do.
Mm-hmm.
I think about what we need to do as a race a race of people, family members, cousins, uncles, whatever, but they're not willing to pull together and pool their resources. The wife I'm married to right now, we had an invitation to go up into West Virginia, and you know, it didn't cost that much for about 3 days and whatever number of nights. And when we got there up in West Virginia, we noticed there were Filipinos, hundreds of them, you know, having a good time. What they do, they pool their money and they're buying up our land. We are Americans. This is what we need to be doing as Black Americans, is pooling our money. But oftentimes we're reluctant to do that because of fear. And it's simple. All you have to do is have paperwork drawn up that's binding, that will protect you and the ones that's investing in your investment business. If you come up with an investment business, mm-hmm. and you pool your money so that when you make your investments and something happens, you should be willing to help those in your family who don't have, if they get sick and they can't pay their mortgage,
uh-huh.
you know, then they lose their house, and then you were there and you could have helped them. That's sad.
Right. Well, I want to touch on the whole pooling capital thing, which is what we were talking about when we're talking about people who, in response to, as part of the Black Lives Matter movement, are saying let's deposit money in black banks. That's really exercise in pooling capital, much like you would see other communities engage. We can do it in our own and black owned banks. And then those banks can, in a very organized way, redistribute capital to people who are in need, make decisions, credit based decisions, and things of that nature to help facilitate creating new wealth, new businesses, supporting those businesses. Absolutely, there are also Filipino Americans who are Americans as well. Their country as well. That's just, you know, their heritage just happens to be Filipino, but we have Americans of from every country. But the cultures of some groups facilitate them working to are such that it facilitates them working cohesively. And for a greater benefit. You
know, and that's a real good point. The question is, in terms of our culture moving forward, how do we do some of those specific things to help change, reorient our culture in that direction? And mm-hmm. I'll give an example. As you mentioned earlier, I'm having the same trouble in my own family, probably less than some. But my extended family, I'm having a little bit more cooperation from. But my immediate family, which at the time was my wife and children, I was having a lot of difficulty getting that kind of cultural change established, where we think economics first and everything else second. And in doing so, if we do this early enough, then you can think about everything else after. Mm-hmm. Because now your foundation is built.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we oftentimes think foundation is built on education. And to some extent it is, but it's only one pillar of the foundation. Lack of economic resources will render education damn near irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
But a lack of education, but tremendous economic resources, might help you become Walmart. So, you know, I don't have to know law, but if I have the capacity financially to hire the right kind of lawyers, the right kind of accountant, the right kind of business managers,
mm-hmm.
Then a lot of folks who have done very, very well in business, especially early on, they had second, third grade educations.
Oh, absolutely.
Especially that's in right. the black community.
Yeah, absolutely.
And we own right. more businesses 50 right. years ago than we do now. And more often than not, folks didn't have much formal education.
Well, A.G. Gaston, he had that famous quote. He said, "I'd rather say I is rich than we are poor." And he was a wealthy man. What would you rather say? I is rich We are poor. You know, we are poor is correct, but I'd rather say I is rich. So, you know, the reality is, yeah, we get out here, we get an education, we go into school, but a lot of times schools just teach us how to be a cog in the machine. The other thing I've heard said is the A students teach the B students who work for the C students while the D and F students get rich, you know. So a lot of times it takes practical understanding, practical ability to execute. People do phenomenal things that don't have, you know, the postdoc, you know, the doctoral degrees and all this type of stuff. And then you see those people who are like professional students. They got 5 doctoral degrees and they live in a college dorm. And so I've also heard.
And I'm one of those that live in the college dorm.
Exactly. Okay. So they say, listen, those who can do, those who can't teach. So what am I saying out there? Am I speaking against education? No. What I'm speaking against is putting too much weight on the degree on the wall. And just assuming that things are going to be successful because we have degrees on the wall. Usually that might be able to help us get a job, but the reality is once you get your first job, you know, nobody asks you about what grades you got in school. They ask you how well did you perform. So it's really about substance and real capability and real value that you bring to the table. So, you know, there's something to be said for practical understanding, and a lot of times people with practical understanding look at something and you can make it, try to make it sound or seem complex, and they distill it to its most simple, simplistic idea, and are successful with it. And I'll give you an example of something that didn't take a rocket scientist to figure out, but the rocket scientist never did. And that is, I don't know if you've ever heard of a company called SpaceX. You guys should Google this company. SpaceX was a company started by a gentleman named Elon Musk, who also started PayPal, who
and
also
Tesla.
And Tesla, and is founder of SolarCity, major owner.
Founder of SolarCity too?
Yeah, him and he started that with his cousins, his two cousins, Lyndon and Peter Rive. He's the largest shareholder in SolarCity. So this guy is brilliant. And one of the things, he had a vision of a private company going to outer space, okay, and taking a rocket ship to outer space. And he put his own money, brought in capital, but he put in massive amounts, you know, millions and millions of dollars of his money into creating SpaceX. And they failed 3 times. Fourth time, they actually were successful in going out into orbit. And the story goes that they ended up with a $1.6 billion contract to supply the U.S. space station. The U.S. space station is presently supplied by a private company. But here's the point that I was getting to. All those years, all those rocket scientists at NASA, all of them kept, have you seen a rocket take off? You watch this massive rocket take off, and the only thing that ever comes back when you see it coming back is that little shuttle. Did you ever wonder what happened to that big old rocket that went up in the sky? And what happens to that big old rocket that goes up in the sky is NASA was just throwing it away. They just use it to get into outer space, and then they just jettison the thing. And, yep, that was that. That's what that was for. We'll build another one. Well, Elon Musk doesn't take a rocket scientist. Elon Musk said, once his private company was doing it, I'm not throwing away that rocket. You know how much money that rocket cost? And he came out with the brilliant idea to have the rocket fly back home, fly back to the Earth, and not only fly back, but now this is where it really got brilliant with the engineers, but it would land standing straight up, prepared to be refueled and take off again. Okay? And this is like, you know, I mean, his launches, I think, are like $250 million per launch cheaper. Okay? But my point is, that didn't take a whole lot of brains to think of that basic concept, let's bring the rocket back. But all those decades in NASA, none of those rocket scientists said, let's bring the rocket back. But it took someone with practical A.G. Gaston type thinking to come up with an innovation that's changed the game. So listen, I want to say thank you to everyone for coming on the show. I want to thank Roland Grimes. I'm excited about being on the Roland Grimes show. Phenomenal host, phenomenal engineer for the show, producing this show, helping us take it to the next level. And then our national treasure, I want to make sure you had the last word here. We're going to get off the air. You got a final word for us?
I want to say that it's a great honor and a pleasure to be a part of this program.
The Hall Street Journal.
Hall Street Journal.
And we appreciate you for being here, sir.
Man, this morning, my spirit is uplifted. I'm encouraged. And I can do greater things than I've already done.
Amen. And you dressed up, too.
Thank you.
I'm going to tighten my game up. Hall Street's going to tighten his game up, you know, because Sir Clarence Sanders is coming in the building. Roland, we appreciate you, sir.
Awesome, man.
All right.
Thanks, sir.
All right, take care and be blessed. Educate, edify, light, entertain. Real talk in the building. See y'all next week.
So you double and dip again, then scream, you scream. Hit your hands up and tell them to get the vein in. Reminiscing can't bring it back to the cabin in Michigan. But man, it's the plan. Say goodbye to your lover, cause it's the end. Off course like the wrong way relay. Need me a boss, you're constant delay. These are the kind of thoughts I've been having for 3 days.